Good morning. We're ready to get started, so if everybody would take our seat. I'm Tim Murphy, and I'm the president of the Franklin Tomorrow Board. On behalf of the board, I'd like to welcome all of you this morning to our FrankTalks. If it's the second Monday of the month, there's odds are there's a FrankTalks happening somewhere. If you'd like to keep notice of where that's going to be and our actual dates, then let Mindy or Carmen know, get your contact information, because we send out an email every month letting everybody know where we are. So, again, thank you all for coming, and we want to thank Vanderbilt for helping us partnering with us on Frank Talks. And thank Lynn Maddox for all she does. Thank you, Lynn. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Mindy Tate, who is the executive director of Franklin Tomorrow, and she's going to introduce our speaker today.
Thanks so much, Tim. First of all, I have to say, go Preds. Yes, go Preds. Woo! Exciting times here in Middle Tennessee for us. Exciting times, whether you're watching the Preds or you're watching the Tennessee legislature, trying to keep score there, too, is pretty interesting, isn't it? Follow the puck is an interesting way of looking at it. We've got a great crowd here this morning. As Tim said, the second Monday of the month means Frank Talks for us. We normally hold that at 9 a.m. on the second Monday of the month with a 30-minute coffee social followed by the program at 9:30. Got a great crowd here tonight. Today, a lot of new faces as well as some familiar faces. We want to thank Fairview Mayor Patty Carroll for being here. Franklin Mayor Ken Moore is here in the front row, and Alderman Ann Peterson is here, elected officials. We've got a new welcome guest. Let's welcome Rob Wigington. Rob is the new Executive Vice President for the Williams County Association of Realtors, and he's in his first couple weeks. So stand up, Rob, and wave so people will see you. Now, there are a lot of faces here, a cast of characters, I would call them, and I think we know that they're here to hopefully get some new information from our special guest, Commissioner John Schroer. We'll see what we can work out of that. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention Alderman Brandy Blanton, so thank you for being here as well. Today is, we're in partnership, as Tim mentioned, with the Vanderbilt University Office of Community, Neighborhood, and Government Relations, and we appreciate their support. And whenever we're talking transportation in Franklin, we're going to involve the TMA group, and we've got Debbie Henry, who's executive director of the TMA group, here in the front row as well. And then Diane Thorne, who's the regional transportation director with the TMA group, and handles their public policy and transportation issues will be with us. And in case you don't know, the TMA group is a regional leader in providing innovative, sustainable, multimodal transportation solutions for employers and communities. TMA operates and manages the award-winning VanStar regional commuter van pool program, the growing local urban public Franklin Transit System, the Clean Air Partnership, and the TDM program. And for those of you who don't know, TDM stands for Transportation on Demand, I believe. Maybe? No? Tell me again. What?
Transportation Demand Management.
Transportation on Demand, but not the same way I said it. So bad on me. We are glad to have you here. We've got a couple things. The mayor wants me to remind you that on May 17th, he will deliver his State of the City address at the New Williams County Enrichment Center. Breakfast starts at 7 and the program at 7:45. And we want to remind you to check out the information on our upcoming Exemplary Community Volunteer Awards, which will be July 26th at the Franklin Theater. We have nominations open until May 19th, and we would be happy to send you a packet of information about that. Okay, so how many of you drove here by yourselves in your car? How many of you walked here? Okay. How many of you rode together? Yay. Thank you for that. How many of you used transit in any form, fashion this morning? Okay. See, there's another whole thing to talk about. we've got with us today Commissioner John Schroer, and to this room, I don't think he needs much of an introduction. He's busy on his phone solving a crisis of the day or the morning. Matt Ligon created a crisis, so we're appreciative of that. But we're going to invite John up to former Mayor Franklin, Commissioner of Transportation for the state of Tennessee, and quickly, and no surprise to many people, has become a leader in the Southeast and across the nation in transportation policy and in looking for transportation trends and solutions that are not necessarily what we have followed for years past. Do you want to stand or stand? He won't sit. Okay, so we'll stand.
Yeah, so thanks, Matt, for is he still here? Yeah. You moved off the back row. You asked me for a favor, so you moved off the back row. Is that what that was? Are we supposed to stay here near that microphone? Okay. So stuff just happens. And so today is the tug. You got good weather for the BGA tug, and we're all excited about that. And we've had an issue before with where it was because it's on a state, it's on a state right away and everything else. So he comes up to me today. So we're having our tug today. And we just noticed that the state has closed down half the lane on 96. And then if they close down the lane, that means all of 96 is closed, which means it'll be bad. So anyway, so he said, I don't know who else to ask. Well, you probably asked the right person. So that's probably the only reason why Matt's here, I would say. Is that true? Yeah, look, it's kind of true. So I'll let you know. I think we're trying to figure out what goes on. But it just goes back. If something bad can happen, it does happen. And I remember one time, June the 14th is Flag Day. And Flag Days, everybody raises their flag. And so for some reason, in some little town in East Tennessee, in the state right-of-way median, for 14 years or some number like that, every year they put up about 100 American flags down the median. And it looks great, but it's illegal. And and so for some reason on that particular, and they just do it on Flag Day once a year, and so for some reason on that day, that year, they decided they were going to take them all down. So they were going to enforce the law after 14 years. And, funny thing, Sean Hannity thought that was a terrible thing. And so on national news, they start talking about how Tennessee took down, 100 American flags on Flag Day. And I would say, what are you thinking? You've been doing this if it was the first time, you could say, no, you can't do that, whatever. Work with the city. Come back the next day. So, one thing that flies out the room oftentimes in city government, in government in general, is common sense. And I don't know what happens when you swear to uphold the Constitution, your common sense goes out the door, maybe. I don't know. No offense to anybody here either in public office or running for public office. And nothing is more obvious to that than when you work with the legislature. And there are none of them here today, which is great. So I can trash them all. I didn't mean that. So today, when we talked, I think when Mindy and I talked about doing this, we thought maybe we could talk about the three-year plan and what's going on and what's going to happen in Williamson County. And as I said a week and a half ago when I was talking to on the Friday morning, whatever that is, Public Affairs Roundtable, and Dave Crouch said, now, are you going to tell us about the three-year plan? I said, no, I'm not, David. And he said, you're not even going to hint? So I'm not going to say a word about it. So he didn't like that answer, but that's the truth. Until the budget is approved, which we think will be today by the Senate, I really can't talk about the three-year plan. And it's a good thing that I didn't, because on Friday, they, in their infinite wisdom, they took $55 million away from the Department of Transportation and spread it out over the counties. And so had I released a three-year plan prior to that, then I would have to go back and redo it, which we were doing this weekend, was redoing a three-year plan minus $55 million. Now, that's not going to be the end of the day for us. It's still, you know, we'll catch up with that. That was really money that we thought we were going to get early on when the budget, when the governor introduced his the improved act the first time. Then they, because it was just going to be, you know, a gas tax from the word go. Now they've gone four, five, six. I can't even remember anymore. Too many numbers involved. So the governor was going to take $55 million out of the general fund and supplement what they were taking away from us to begin with, because we'd already planned on that money, and so the legislature took it back. The House took it back on Friday. I don't know if you all watched the disaster on Thursday when they were all mad at each other and saying ugly things to each other, and then on Friday morning they all sang Kumbaya, holding hands. They were all apologizing all over each other on Friday morning. So I'd taken a day off, and I just was listening to it and driving down the road trying to get my garden worked on. But anyway, so today my assumption is the Senate will pass the House bill that they approved, and then it'll go on to the governor's desk for final signature, and they'll go home in the next couple of days. Those of us that work with them are really happy for them to go home. Do you all know that when they're in session, that above the Capitol there's a third flag raised? Do you all know that? Most of you don't know that, do you? So I didn't know it either until I went down there. And we were hoping it was going to be Friday, because we were going to celebrate not Cinco de Mayo, but the legislators go home day. And my office, some of you have been, I've got a view of the Capitol. I've got a spectacular office, and I have a view of the plaza and the Capitol. And when they lower that flag, we break out the champagne, and though we don't drink in state office building. So I know you're all probably interested in it. So I'm not going to tell you about what's going to be in a three-year plan, because it's still in its final draft. I'll look at it here in about an hour. We'll re-present it back to the governor, and then when the Senate passes the bill, we'll probably release that plan probably tomorrow, would be my guess. And so there's, you know, the thing we can talk about the Improve Act is, you know, let's start back at the beginning. And about 2 years ago, the governor and I went around the state, and we had a listening tour about the needs across the state and what people wanted in every community. And then we spent the next year and a half kind of putting that together and then convincing the legislators that there was a need. I had many, many of them, and Kent Starwell, would you stand up? Just do that. Kent Starwell is head of the, is the executive director of the Tennessee Road Builders. And I will say this publicly, without Kent, the Improve Act would not have passed. He and his team put so much effort into it, and lobbied and worked really, really hard. And he only did that because he lives in West Haven. Just saying, Kent. You know, there's some truth to some of everything I say. But the effort that they put in was phenomenal, and a lot of people say that, you know, self-serving and all that kind of good stuff. The road builders do a great job for the state of Tennessee, and without them we wouldn't have the quality roads that we have. And there's several consultants and road builders follow me around like I'm going to give them money when they're done with it. But I got a group of consultants back there. They hang out. That's good. But without all that, you know, without the work that we have and the partnership that we have with the road builders, we wouldn't have the great roads that we do. And I think it's really important. And they deserve you know, a hand. And Kent, I appreciate it. I'm going to introduce one other person. My daughter-in-law is here. I have to introduce her. Jody, you stand up so everybody can see you. She happens to be the mother of my grandson, so I don't really care about, but she's the mother of my grandson. So with that, so where do we stand, and what does that happen? What impact does it have on Williams County? So during that whole process when the governor and I rocked and rolled and went around the state, we have what was called originally a backlog list, and a backlog list are projects that we've spent money on. They're in some form of development, and a road project literally takes somewhere between 8 and 12 years to get from conception to completion, 8 to 12 years. And that's an abomination that it takes that long, truly. In the private sector, you know, I'm a commercial real estate developer. If it took 12 years to develop something, I'd been broke on about the fourth year. But we don't have to do all the things in the private sector that you do in the public sector, and mainly that's environmental issues that we've got to go through. And it's not just, when we say the word environment, it's not just, you know, you're killing, you know, birds or anything. It's a whole mass of lots of things. There's economic things, there's architectural things, there's historical artifacts, there's all these, it's a whole plethora of different things that we have to look at. And, you know, we have to look to make sure that we're not disturbing the possible habitat of the Indiana bat, as an example. Now, we don't have to see if there are any bats there or not. We just know that if it's a possible habitat for an Indiana bat, that we're not supposed to disturb that. So I don't know about you, but I'd be sick if we lost that Indiana bat. I don't know what we would do. But anyway, so those are some of the things that we have to go through. And it's very frustrating at times when you're trying to get projects done. And the thing, and I'm really off on a tangent here, but the thing that really concerns me is we got a lot of roads where people are dying on. And we need to fix them, and we need to fix them quickly, and yet we're still being held back for other things that might be important, but I guarantee they're not important as that person's life that might be lost on a road that needs to be fixed. So we're hoping that maybe some of that will be kind of lifted slightly as we go forward with the Trump administration, some of those things that have gotten, you know, out of sorts, that have gone too far, that we can maybe back up a little bit and get projects delivered a little quicker, and we haven't seen that yet, but maybe we will, and as we go forward. So let's get back to Williams County. So a bunch of roads. There's I think there were 22 projects identified in the Improve Act at a cost of about $460 million in Williamson County. That's a lot of projects, and they're of different variety, and one, of course, is Mac Hatcher. We can talk a little bit about that. You know, Mac Hatcher is one of those projects. This is an interesting story. So when I was the mayor of Franklin eons ago, it seems now, the mayor of Franklin, myself, went to the governor and begged for them to build Mac Hatcher. That it was an important road, and we had to get it done. We thought of all sorts of different ways that we might could do it. We were trying to build it ourselves and then get the state to pay us back. That didn't work. I didn't understand why it didn't work. I understand it now, but I didn't back then. It seemed like a great idea at the time. Of course, it was mine. So, you know, like I got a little sign in my office, everyone's entitled to their opinion as long as it's the same as mine. So, anyway. But, you know, and so everyone was sure that when I got up there that Mac Hatcher would be the first project that was built because I really campaigned for it. And then, you know, anytime those of you and that are in elected position, well, you run and you say, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, we're going to do that. And then you get in office and you're like, oh, I can't do that. Doesn't hurt you to say it. And that's why incumbents really have a hard time sometimes because they know they can't do certain things. And people running against them can say all they want because they don't know the difference. So for those of you that are running, you can understand how that works. But so we really, you know, we prioritize all of our projects. I will say, when we were in Franklin, the Ken and I and the other aldermen worked really hard. Ann Peterson's back there. She was on a board when I was there. Worked really hard to start prioritizing our projects. We really didn't prioritize anything until we were elected. It was just kind of hit and miss, and whatever actually the city administrator wanted to build, that's what we built, and there was no listing of priorities. We had no idea you know, where projects were along the line, and really not a way to run anything. And so we developed a really good priority system. I think in some form or fashion it's still there, and we're doing the things that we need to do as a city, prioritizing the projects so the citizens know what the elected officials are looking at, and that the city staff themselves know what the priorities are, so they know how to prioritize the work that they're doing on roads that are in the development process. It's a logical thing. So when I went to the state, I said, man, this is going to be great, because I know they've got a great priority project, because they're the state, and they do all this stuff, and they do all these projects. I get, but they have no way of prioritizing projects when I went to the state. And it was really done in a back room, truly in a back room, with four or five people, and they said, well, we'll do this one, this one, this one. And I said, that is no way to figure out a road program. And so we developed a very complicated prioritization program that has about 17 rankings, and not only do our local people across the state work on that, but we do internally in our headquarters. Our top three priorities are safety, congestion, and economic development. And then they drop down from there, but it's how we prioritize. And we got some 450 projects under development. So just think about this, so you know how massive the department is. My budget this year will be $2.1 billion. We've got about 4,000 employees. I currently have under construction about 400 projects under construction at a cost of about $3 billion. We roll off about $1 billion a year, add about $1 billion a year. When the Improve Act goes, we'll add a little bit more, about $1.2 billion a year, be rolling off about $1 billion as well. So I've got 400 projects under construction and 400 projects under development all at one time. It's a pretty massive undertaking, and so we do have to prioritize, and so we go from there. So when we started doing the list and we started prioritizing everything, you know, and we look at what has to be done. And again, safety is the number one criteria. And so, you know, Matt Catcher is in that process. And the good thing about Matt Catcher, which gives it some opportunity of being built in the near future, is that the city stepped up and has committed dollars to that project. And that makes a difference for us. And what we try to do is leverage our state dollars as well as we can. And if a community is willing to contribute and add money to it, one is that's putting their money where, we always say, put your money where you get skin in the game, put your money where your mouth is, whatever. If you really want a project, and if you can, put money into it, and that shows us for sure that's where you want to spend your money, so that should be where we want to spend our money as well. So Matt Catcher's a project, I think they've already put in nearly $6 million, some number like that in that project. So that really, really pushes our ability to do a project like that. And I will say Columbia Pike is sort of the same thing. Obviously, it's kind of in a controversial stage right now, and rightfully so. There's a lot of concern about that. About that project, as there are a lot of projects. We deal with those issues every day when you're taking right away and infecting ingress and egress to businesses and how that works, and it's a difficult project. We did that when we did the streetscape project. You know, lots of impact on businesses, ingress and egress. I think in the long run, that's all positive. It hurts in the short run. And I know Columbia Avenue will be that way. In the case of Columbia Avenue, what we structured to deal with the city is that city has some federal dollars coming through the MPO, their STP dollars, and so they can use federal dollars to build it. The state agreed to match, to put the local match to the federal dollars. So the city's putting up, with their federal dollars, 80% of the project, and the state's putting up the 20% match, which requires on federal dollars. So the city's designing, building, arranging all of that stuff. We're just adding the cash, the 20% match, which, again, is a great leverage for us. It's a state highway. We need to know that's a state highway. And so we agree in that it needs to be widened, and maybe don't necessarily agree on exactly what's going on, but we do know it needs to be widened, and that's a critical piece of the whole development of what we're doing. So Matt Catcher, you know, that side of Matt Catcher is way into the future, but one thing that's not way in the future is four-laning Matt Catcher from Columbia Pike all the way over to 96. That's part of the Improve Act, as a matter of fact. So it's in the Improve Act. It needs to be done. I know Ann Peterson likes that piece. I will tell you that piece is probably more important than the Northwest side. But don't say that to West Haven people. But it's an important piece of kind of the loop. And then finally the Southeast side is important as well, and I think we'll do some design work on that and try to get that moving so that ultimately we have, you know, the full bypass around the city. You know, that started in the early 1980s was when that whole Mack Hatcher process kind of got started, and we're still working on it, though it took almost 30 years to build 840, so, you know, who knows how long that stuff will take. So hopefully tomorrow we'll release that plan and know that in that plan, again, as I said, there's 22 projects, $450 some odd million worth of work just in Williamson County. Overall, $10.5 billion worth of work, 962 projects, a lot of local bridges that need to be done. We're looking forward to working on those. And so I will stop there. Yes, ma'am.
So one thing you can talk about from the Improve Act is that the local option portion of that, mm-hmm. and then we could talk with the TMA group
That'd be great.
A little bit about that.
Yeah. So as part of the bill, and probably, again, one of the reasons why it got passed, because we got a lot of local support from some of the bigger cities, and which tend to be an interesting thing about this state is that the five biggest cities in the state of Tennessee have Democratic mayors, and I don't know if you all notice that, but it is something to think about. And I'm just locally you don't run, you know, by party, and so, you know, it's a little bit different. When you do at state, you have to think of those things. And so the Improve Act passed because we had a split in the Republican Party, and the Improve Act passed because, you know, about half the Republicans wanted it, and we got all but two of the Democrats that voted for it. So it was a bipartisan passage of that bill, at least in the House. And so that helped us do that. And one of the reasons was because of the local option piece that's there. And the local option piece allows larger counties and the five large, Kent knows all this, the five largest cities in the state to do a local option. Four largest and 12 counties. There you go. I didn't follow that much. You know, my job is, you know, somebody says, well, what, you know, talk about, are you campaigning for this bill and what, you know, what have you? Are you glad it's done? I said, no, now that it's done, now my work begins, because my job is to build the roads and bridges that are there, and really not necessarily campaign for the money. Because our job, and the reason why I got hired for this job, and Jody will understand this, is my job as the Commissioner of Transportation is to spend every penny that we get. Now, we do that in our household, and so I'm really qualified for that. And so between Marianne and I, we have like $3 in our bank account. And that's the way you run a transportation department. You spend every penny that you get. We don't want to leave any money in Washington. Those are, you know, our dollars that we send to Washington, and they send it back with strings attached. And we want to make sure that we get every dollar back, because those are our dollars. Even though they may have strings, we don't want to leave them there to go to another state. So we have to make sure that we do all that stuff. So anyway, four and 12. So what that really means is that the larger communities, if they so deem and they want to have transit of some form or fashion, can raise additional dollars through other forms of taxation that are already on the books in order to fund transit. Now, that's easier said than done, and it has to be approved by the local governing body and then go to a referendum in order to get that happen. Nashville's already announced that they're going to do that in 2018. And they want to do a transit deal, and they want to do it on Gallatin Road, which is real interesting because that's a state highway, and they didn't ask us about that. And So that'll be an interesting concept because they want to take lanes out of Gallatin Road, and there's no right-of-way on either side, which cuts the flow. Our job is to provide the flow of traffic and stuff. So we'll have to have some conversation. That just doesn't happen automatically. And you know, again, if we're going to talk about transit from Williamson County to Nashville, which or Rutherford County to Nashville, you know, everybody's looking at that. You know, the Gallatin Road process doesn't help anybody at all coming from the regions. It will help Nashvillians, but it won't help those that are coming in. You know, I would say Williamson County, and I'll shut up after that if you want me to, but Williamson County is really unique in the fact that we have almost the same amount, and Ken, you know, almost the same amount of people coming from Nashville to Williamson County on a daily basis as going the other direction, which then means your reverse commute can be profitable. No transit is profitable, just so you know. It all has to be funded and subsidized in order to make it work. But when the train is going, or whatever it is, going the other direction can be full, it makes a big difference. It makes it more realistic. That doesn't happen in any other location across the state. So another question?
We'll come back to you. For you want to have a little sip of your drink or coffee, whatever that is. You're going to share? I don't know. It might even be better.
It is Monday morning.
We have Diane Thorne, who's with the TMA Group and Regional Transportation Manager for them. And Diane, talk a little bit about the local option, the opportunities that exist there, but already the plans that are in place for transit and the positive impact it can possibly have for commuters both in and out of Williamson County.
Thank you, Mindy. When Commissioner Schwarr was talking about passing the gas tax bill, how far back I go, we came into office. I was assistant commissioner in 1987. That 1986 road plan had just passed. There were 400 projects on it. They did it right this time. TDOT identified the projects in advance. Well, the legislature identified the projects as they decided to vote yes or no on the gas tax bill. So we came in 87, we had 400 some projects, and we were shell-shocked. And then about a couple years later, we needed another gas tax increase, which was the last one, I guess it was in 89. And we simply wanted to raise the gas tax, one penny, and I don't remember what it was for diesel. No-brainer, easy going. As a matter of fact, when it came up in the Senate Transportation Committee, the commissioner was out of town because it was a no-brainer. Comes up in the Senate Transportation Committee, conversation was great, unanimous vote to move it on. Then the next step. They continue, other bills come up in the Senate Transportation Committee. I don't remember the bill, but they got really pissed off about it. And the next thing that happened was I heard someone say, well, let's just recall the transportation bill. And we're sitting there, we're thinking, oh, no. So Katie Varney and I were working together on that at that time. Katie worked for the governor, I worked for the commissioner. I told Katie, if you'll tell the commissioner, I'll tell the governor. Because we had to bring him back from vacation to get the bill through. So it doesn't sound like a whole lot of things have changed up there. I think we learned a lot of things in that. Oh, me. Well, you know, I know that our roadway system in Tennessee is one of the best in the country. And the roadway system is the basic foundation for all of our transportation. Everything else really starts and ends with a roadway system. The bridges are important, and if you've ever had a bridge collapse, which happened during that administration, there is nothing that I can imagine much worth with the transportation system that can happen. So, but where we work on the other side, actually my career, I've started in transportation with the road builders and worked assistant commissioner at TDOT and was Mayor Purcell's infrastructure advisor in Franklin, RTA executive director, and now with the TMA group and Franklin Transit Authority. I've been there for about 10 years and it's been a wonderful opportunity. Some of my road builder friends say that I crossed over to the dark side. when I went to the transit side and transportation demand management. But you've got this roadway system, and it's not about how many cars can you move on that roadway system. It's really about how many people can you move on that roadway system. Gresham Smith right now is under contract with TDOT to do a study on the I-65 multimodal corridor study from the Kentucky line to the Alabama line. That's underway right now. The MPO in Nashville has promised Mayor Moore that they will do an I-65 transit study, because it's like Commissioner Shore said, there's about as many people coming into Williamson County in the morning as are leaving Williamson County in the morning. So we hope that that study will get underway sometime within the next fiscal year. And, you know, one of the things right now, if we had the money, let's say that the decision was made to build a light rail corridor between Franklin and Nashville. If the decision was made to do that today, it would probably be 15 years before you'd ever see it. And talking with the mayor of Charlotte one time, when they passed a dedicated sales tax for their transportation system, he said one of the hardest things to do as an elected official is to go out of the limb for a dedicated tax for these types of projects. And you go through one term, and the public sees nothing happening. You go through another term, and the public sees nothing happening. So they wonder, what in the world are you doing with that money? It's just that the process is incredibly long, especially if you're going to do a rail-type project. Not as long if you're going to do a BRT project, but there's still a ton of hurdles that you have to go through. You know, there was a lot of people in Williamson County and Davidson County, all the counties around here, that worked on this in focus plan. It was a transit, multimodal transportation plan. But you know, at the end of the day, what it comes down to is you can put everything that you'd like to see and all your dreams and all your hopes, but if you don't have the funding there, you don't get to move to the next level. One of the things that the city of Franklin did last year when they raised the property tax, they dedicated a small portion of that tax to transit and sidewalks and things that are really important to this community. As far as I know, the city of Franklin is the only city government, county government, anywhere in probably the state of Tennessee that's done that. So what we're fortunate here in Williamson County is our leaders here, they get it. They know that with the growth that we're looking at by 2040, I think I've read maybe almost a 40% growth here. You've got the new land use plan that Franklin's done that takes a look at incorporating transit into every element where it fits. And so at the TMA group, what we do, we not only run the small urban system in Franklin, we run a regional van pool program, which our regional van pools carry more people every day than the Music City Star. Our van pool program brings a lot of money into this region for roadway projects. And then we also work on the side called transportation demand management. And that's about moving more people instead of more cars on our roadway. We have a picture that we use all the time that shows our roadways, just everybody sitting. Well, if you have a 60-person bus, that removes, and there's 60 people on, that takes 60 cars off of that roadway. If you have a van, if it has 15 people on it, that's 15 cars. So you start adding all that up. And there's another element that we're working on, are going to start working on really hard, and it's carpooling. Think about how many empty seats we all have every day going to and from Nashville, or Murfreesboro, or Columbia. There's a lot of empty seats. So how do we make it easier for people to share a ride? So that's one of the things that we work on. And Mobility Week that they had, that was held here in Williamson County last year, there was a commitment from a lot of employers to do compressed work weeks, short work days or longer work days. Does everybody have to be at work at 8 o'clock in the morning? Does everybody have to get off at 5? Does everybody have to work Monday through Friday? Can some people work Tuesday through Friday? And if you just think about, one time we were saying we were going to reduce traffic on the interstate by 10%. So then we took that 10% and we applied it, and we discovered that there were not enough buses in the southeast to reduce the traffic by 10%. So there's got to be another solution, and it's got to start with you and me. It's got to start with our employers. It's got to start with people thinking their way through it. Because, you know, if it's 15 years, what are we going to do in that 15-year period when there is, while we're waiting for that light rail project to start? Development's going to continue because we're prosperous. We're going to continue to grow. People want to live here. But there will be a point in time, if we don't find solutions ourselves, it won't be such a great place to live. We did the Carruthers Parkway study for multimodal study because when they were looking at the traffic that's going to be generated there at Carruthers and McEwen, it was going to take something like a 12-lane interchange there. You know what that does? That changes the whole character of our community. So we were brought in to do a study on how we can engage people to be part of the solution. And so that's what we do a lot here in Franklin. Will a referendum be easy to pass? No, it won't be easy to pass. We will have to make an amazing case for, and we're going to have to show people what they're going to get for it. And even then, it will be hard. But I think that we can make the case. I think all of us working together can make the case. Not one person alone can do it. So we've got to get the buy-in to be successful. And everybody in this room has got to be part of the solution.
Thank you, Diane. Let's thank Diane. And we'll take some questions in a bit. We've got Franklin Mayor Ken Moore here, and it's a great opportunity for him in his regional role to tell us briefly about the I-65 corridor study and the status of that. But also, we're hearing about growth. Someone mentioned the 40% growth rate and the jobs that are coming in along with that. There's concern about not just regionally roads, but locally roads and transit systems. So can you just briefly talk about I-65 corridor study and local roads?
The answer is no, I can't talk briefly about it because there's a whole lot to it. And but first of all, I appreciate Diane mentioning that we've made a commitment locally to work on our transportation, and the 1 cent that we dedicated our property tax to multimodal. We're funding a bike share program this year. We've given additional money to the Franklin Transit Authority to improve their routes and take the headway from an hour to 30 minutes, and also actually change the type of routing that we have to improve our local transportation. Diane mentioned that it'd take 15 years to get a rapid transit or whatever you want to call it, train or monorail or whatever it might be. But today, if it were here today, it would fail because we don't have the solution locally yet to make sure that we get people there quickly enough. You mentioned In Motion. The In Motion study, I participated in that study, and I was a little disappointed that it didn't really address the South Corridor more. That's why the I-65 study that Commissioner Shore mentioned is very important. And I'm glad to say that the South Corridor study, which we've been asking for, been told we would get, has been funded now. And I'm told that that starts early summer, according to Steve Bland from the RTA. And we've all insisted that that particular study make sure that it's a full study and not some kind of little piecemeal study. So that's it.
That was brief. You can do it. I'm sure he'll be more thorough on May 17th at his State of the City address, again, at the Williams County Enrichment Center, May 17th, 7 a.m. You don't have to RSVP for that. As I mentioned in the introduction, Commissioner Shore has taken a lead both in the Southeast and nationally as a transportation leader and coming together. He also recently talked about riding in the autonomous vehicles, and the Tennessee, the State Senate approved a bill about autonomous vehicles, allowing them in Tennessee, but ride sharing. We've got Christian here from Hitch. Talk a little bit about autonomous vehicles and answer. So my question is, can we build our way out of congestion? And what role can autonomous vehicles play in that?
Brought my cup with me, just in case. So I think, can we build our way out of congestion? Kent's going, yeah, we can. That's great. How's it working for the dark side? Is it okay? So Kent doesn't like me to say this, but here's kind of a dilemma that we're faced with in the Department of Transportation. So right now, our interstates, this is nationally, not locally, but nationally, are used at somewhere between a 10 and 12% capacity. That's full time, about 10%. Let's use the number 10%. And so if you, I always do things kind of differently, but assume you own a hotel and you have 100 rooms and you operate at a 10% capacity. So that means you have 10 rooms that you occupy every day. But every so often, you have excess demand. So maybe once a week, you have 150 people that want to have a room. Now, here's what happens. So if you own that hotel, so for those times that you're full, you have to have your hotel ready for all 100 rooms have to be ready. So they have to be ready all the time because you don't know when that is. So you have to have full staff, you have to have kitchen, you have to have food, you have to do everything else, and you throw a whole bunch of stuff away because it's not being used because it's only being used 10% of the time. So the question then is, but every so often I have demand for 150 rooms. Am I going to build another 50 rooms in order to meet that particular demand that happens once a week or once every other month, just so that I'm full on those days? And the answer is no, you'd go broke doing that. So we really do have to look at how we utilize the capacity that we have. I don't believe you can build your way out of this issue. I do think, and I use this, and I don't know if this is true, this is purely John Schroer's kind of looking at things. So if you look at, which is really strange, if you're in here bouncing around, it is awful. But what you realize is that I was looking at traffic counts from Murfreesboro into Nashville and Franklin into Nashville, and they're about the same. They truly are. And but then I think there's traffic so much worse in Rutherford County into Nashville than it is from Franklin, and it's bad in Franklin. But I drive it every day, so nobody can complain. I do it every day. And I drive 96 like people from West Haven do every day, too. Just thought I'd throw that in. So when someone says, you don't understand, oh, yes, I do understand. I'm on 96 every day, twice a day. But, and then we started looking at timing of the driving. And what we realized is that the traffic is more congested in 24 because there's more traffic at a particular time or in a length of time than it is in Williamson County. And a lot of that has to do with the demographics of the two communities. And what I mean by that is that Rutherford County is more of a middle-class city. I don't take any offense to that, but it kind of is. And if you look at the incomes of everybody, and people that have those type of jobs tend to have less flexibility in the timing of their jobs. And they have to be there at 8 or 7:30, or that's when they have to be there. As you get up the ladder, as jobs and where you are, you have a little bit more flexibility. And so you can kind of stage your driving a little bit. I do. I don't go in the office until about 8:30 or 9 o'clock. I stay at home, work out, and go in late, and then work late and come home because I miss the traffic. So if we all go into Nashville right now, we'll breeze right through. There'll be no problem going into Nashville right now. So a lot of things we really have to work with is when people go to work. And you mentioned that. That's a critical issue. If everybody altered that and changed how they went to work, we would have the ability to have we wouldn't have to do all the building. And you know, the state's doing about 14% of our workforce is now work at home, which is really a great thing, and that cuts back on traffic. So a lot of things as a country we need to do and as a city we need to do. Now, what Mindy talked about is autonomy, so I had to say that. And it ties into that. Whether you want it or not, it's coming. So just so you know that. So those of you, my grandson, Jody's son, will never drive a car. He's 4 years old. That's my prediction. He will never drive a car. And driving a car in that time will be similar to owning a horse. You'll do it for recreation. You'll have to go someplace special to drive it in order to practice it and all those kind of good things, and that's what will happen. And that has a huge impact on transportation without question. I was in a conference in California with a bunch of really smart people. And I don't know why they let me in, but they did. And the question was asked to all these smart people, how many people think that autonomous vehicles will decrease the amount of congestion? And half the people raised their hand. And so how many people think it will increase congestion? Half the people raise their hand. So the answer is nobody knows, except here's what I'll tell you. And here's what we need to know about autonomous vehicles. They're smarter than we are. That's without question. They drive better than we do. They don't look at their cell phones. They don't, you know, drink and drive. They don't do those kind of things. Last year, 2016, this is what you need to know. 40,000 people died on our roads. Almost 90% of those were driver error. And in my job, which is 1,070 people died in Tennessee last year. And I got an email for every one of them. So if you look into your email every day and talk about, and you know how many people die every day on your roads, which I do, it really starts to eat at you. And what can we do to make our roads safer? I think our roads are really safe right now. Very few accidents are caused because of the road. They're caused because drivers do something dumb or bad. And the only way to solve that is to have autonomous vehicles. And they are smart. They know what they're doing. I rode about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I rode in Mountain View, California in a Google car for 2 hours without any set route, and the driver of the car who was sitting there never touched the accelerator, the brake, or the steering wheel. And it was after about 50, I've ridden in three or four of them. This was the most extensive drive that I had. And someone was holding a computer and showing me everything the car was seeing. So it was reading what the car was seeing. It's phenomenal what they're looking at and what the computer can. And it saw someone on a bicycle before we saw it, saw somebody walking before we saw it, has all sorts of stuff that it can do, and it can operate that way. And so we're going to be there. It may save your children's life, your life, your wife's life, whatever. It will happen. And think of the fact that we could literally save 40,000 car lives a day. I use that as an example. So a car, say a jet airplane holds 200 people, okay? And so if you divide 200 into 40,000, I think that's 200, if I'm not mistaken. So let me ask you this question. If you knew every year that 200 jet airplanes would crash in the United States, would any of you ever catch an airplane? Ever? And yet every day you're traveling on something that has that same amount of risk. And, you know, my grandson, unfortunately, has a better chance of being killed in a driving to work, going with his mother, going to school, than anything else that he does. The car wrecks are the number one fatality reasons for people from age of 0 to 41. And we as a nation have the ability to stop that. And that's by embracing and making sure the technology can go to our vehicles and our vehicles can make those decisions of what they do. We're going to be there. And it will have a huge impact on our country. I have in my office a picture of Fifth Avenue, New York City, Easter Sunday morning, 1900. And it's loaded with vehicles, you know, from building to building. It's a dirt road. There's one of the vehicles has an engine. The rest of them have horses. I have a similar picture taken. I didn't create these. I found these. On Easter Sunday morning, Fifth Avenue, New York City, 1913. 13 years later, not a single vehicle is being pulled by a horse. Every one of them has an engine, 4 wheels, a steering wheel, an accelerator, and a brake. And since that time, think of that, cars have not changed at all because they all have those things in common. They have 4 wheels, a steering wheel, an engine, an accelerator, and a brake. Everything else is an amenity. we're now getting ready to change. And I think that time period is exactly the same. I think that 13-year time period is exactly the same and where we'll be. It's kind of bizarre to think about that. Lots of different opinions on where we'll go, but we will be there. So how was that?
Okay, Kent, you've taken a lot of hits this morning. Kent Starwalt, do you have a question or a comment this morning?
All I got a note was the road's clear. How about that? Matt has a spy on it. So it must have worked. He asked the right person.
Great. We try to keep this within an hour's time frame, and we've got 2 minutes here. So we've got time for a quick question. Jay Edward, you first.
By the way, I was for the gas tax, but and I'm glad it passed. But I've heard you speak before, Mayor Shore, Commissioner Shore, and isn't it true that when we look at transportation, that electric cars have had a dramatic impact on reducing the gas tax?
No. Yeah, I think most, there's only 2,500 electric cars in the state of Tennessee, so they have had no impact on that whatsoever. Now, there is going to be a $100 fee for electric cars. That's only $250,000 a year. Again, very little impact. Now, I think as we go forward in the future, I will tell you that every single autonomous car is electric. So as we go to that mode, we will be there. They will all be electric at some point in time. And so the regular engine that we drive will be the one we have to go to somebody's farm and drive on an old backcountry road or do something that's not, so that's where we're there.
One question. Go ahead.
Oh,
great. Well, I'm going to go over here to Nancy Conway and let her answer that question. Who was Mac?
What did he say?
He said you might have dated him.
Not quite. He was a very tall man. He was a wonderful gentleman, a resident, probably a native of Williamson County, what I vaguely remember. And he was our Williamson County roads director. Very popular, very down to earth, and a caring person. And after his death, of course, the bypass was named for him.
And I'll admit to being at the grand opening of the first section of the Mac Hatcher bypass, too. So let's thank Commissioner Schroer and Diane Thorne for being here today. Just a reminder, please mark your calendars for the second Monday in June. We'll get information to you. I want to also say thank you to Mary Lee Bennett and Patrick Baggett from our Franklin Tomorrow Board of Directors who chair our FrankTalks Committee. Y'all wave. If you all have a suggestion for a program, we'd love to hear it. You'll get a follow-up email. And now that you, if we didn't get your email, if you didn't register in advance, please get that on over here at the table so we can make sure to add you to the list. But again, thank you, Commissioner Schroer, and we look forward to hearing from you again.